الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن محمد رسول الله أشهد أن محمد رسول الله حي على الصلاة حي على الصلاة حي على الفلاح حي على الفلاح الله أكبر الله أكبر لا إله إلا الله
إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستهديه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فهو المهتد ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله وصفيه من خلقه وخليله فصلى الله عليه صلاة وسلاما يليقان بمقام سيد الأنبياء وإمام المرسلين. My dear respected brothers and sisters, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reminds all of us about consciously protecting ourselves from the anger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, from disobeying Allah. Allah said in the Quran, بعد أن أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله ولتنظر نفس ما قدمت لغد واتقوا الله إن الله خبير بما تعملون. Believers, fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, protect yourselves from disobeying Allah, and let every soul think and reflect what it prepared for tomorrow, for the afterlife. And fear Allah, because Allah is aware of everything that you do. My khutbah today is a little bit emotional. I will be sharing some stories and some reflections from a class for deaf Muslims that we started at our local masjid at the Islamic Center of Detroit. And I will try, and I took it upon myself, to share all the spiritual lessons that I am learning by teaching this class. So Bismillah, we start that every time you attend, and I invite everyone to come and maybe listen and attend some of those classes, I feel that I'm washing my heart every time I teach my dear deaf Muslim brothers and sisters. Mixed feelings, some of them remembering, the obvious ones, remembering the ni'am, the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on us. Other feelings that I feel about the greatness of Islam, the amazing Islam that it can be explained to PhDs in psychology and logic and philosophy. At the same time, when you talk to deaf Muslims through an interpreter, an American Sign Language, you have to make your message very simple. You have to dumb it down to the most simpler way. And alhamdulillah, Islam can talk to both people. Islam can talk. And the Quran, subhanAllah, how amazing is the Quran. I reflect on the ayah where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about the Quran, وَلَقَدْ يَسَّرْنَا الْقُرْآنَ لِلذِّكْرِ فَهَلْ مِنْ مُدَّكِرِ. We made the Quran so simple for remembrance. We make it easy. We made it accessible. So is there anyone who can remind and get and reflect upon this Quran? It makes me think about how we live in Western community, Western society, and how, subhanAllah, there's a lot of accommodations for people with special needs. Whereas in the Muslim world, we are struggling with this. Even in the Muslim community in the West, we have an issue. For look at any masjid at the handicapped parking, and we find it, you know, an issue always people parking where they're not supposed to be parking. So subhanAllah, accommodating brothers with special needs, with special, and subhanAllah, let me change our wording and our terminology a little bit. From now on, let's take from our dictionary that they are people with special needs. They are in fact people with special talents. And my khutbah will be discussing this by examining some examples from our great Muslim history of Sahaba, of companions of the Prophet ﷺ with special talents, not special needs. Why this is relevant to us? Why this is relevant to me and you, and to the old man, to the young man, to the brothers and sisters? Because let's be honest about it, we complain a lot. We might have everything in this world, but we are still complaining. And we don't look at what we have and try to utilize it. So the first message is concerning me and you and everyone. Some people who might be physically fine, there's no apparent disability or need for them, but they have an emotional disability. They cannot get beyond the negativity, the laziness, the pessimism, the loop that they are always in. Some people have emotional disability. And subhanAllah, I will be sharing with you from the Quran, from the ayat of the Quran, what is the definition of a truly disabled person? The person who truly needs your attention, your help, your dua, your sympathy, your tears. And it's definitely not someone with an apparent physical challenge or disability. I'll be talking about the ayah from the Quran that says, صُمٌّ بُكْمٌ عُمْيٌ فَهُمْ لَا يَرْجِعُونَ. And at the end of the khutbah, I will try to share some messages for families of brothers or sisters with special talents and for the community at large. SubhanAllah, when this message came to us mid-January to the ICD, that sister wanted a class for the deaf. And she offered a translator, but she wanted someone who can teach this class in English. And she was begging for help. She's like, please help us. SubhanAllah, when we started teaching, we saw amazing things. We saw that there was some confusion, and I'm not blaming them. It's a blame to us, because we didn't accommodate them. We found some confusion in their perception and their definition of God versus Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. One of the questions I was asked, do we worship Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam? And this is because most of their perception of religion came from Christianity, came from the church. So the idea of God versus Jesus and the Trinity, this was communicated to Islam. It was not as trivial as it sounds to explain to them that this is Quran and this is Hadith. This is speech of Muhammad and this is speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the Quran. Some of the girls who was deaf, and she was 6 years old, she actually said, I'm Christian. Well, I mean, what's wrong with it? She didn't even have maturity enough to understand the difference. Despite all that, I can guarantee to you that they have sincerity when it comes to talking to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So if someone does not talk to people, this does not mean that they don't have spirituality. Because it's all about connection and talking to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I can tell you one reaction when I was asked a question, very simple question. I get this from the youth every day. Like if somebody offended me, how should I reply? How should I talk back to them? So I told them, I can answer you. Any Muslim can answer you, but I want Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to answer you. Open the Quran to Surah Fussilat, to the ayah, اِدْفَعْ بِالَّتِي هِيَ أَحْسَنْ فَإِذَا الَّذِي بَيْنَكَ وَبَيْنَهُ عَدَاوَةٌ كَأَنَّهُ وَلِيٌّ حَمِيمٌ. That reply back, the bad with good, and the enemy will become a friend. And when they read the ayah from the Quran, when they got the answer directly from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you can tell the effect on their face, because they are communicating to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. With this being said, the first part of my khutbah, let's change our definition. They are not people with special needs, There are people with special talents. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala might take something out from you, but He will give you a lot. I was watching this TED talk about a deaf soldier in the American army, and he was sharing his story, and you can just Google it. It's deaf in the military. And he was sharing his story about how he struggled and how he fought to be accepted to the American army. And they refused him, and he showed them that I can serve my country. I am part of the community. I can do like anyone else. And now he traveled all the way to the Middle East, to the occupied, beloved Palestine, to Israel actually. And where he met seven other deaf soldiers in the Israeli army. And despite all their oppression and their, you know, crying, subhanAllah, they felt that these people should be included in our army. They should serve our country. So they were serving in the logistics in the Israeli army. And he went back to the US and told the American army, I can serve my country, I'm not less than them. And now he used to wake up and he wanted to go and train and join that boot camp. And he was always in the second line and he would be training and he would be, practicing. And he's always watching those in the front row. But then he was so proud when the trainer asked him to go to the first row. He's like, you can learn it and you don't have to watch others and you don't have to even listen and you can be who you are. How they raised the bar on him. And he was so proud of this and he's sharing this story to the other, community. This reminded me of the great Sahabi, of someone with a special talent, not special need, Abdullah bin Umm Maktoum, radiallahu anhu wa ardah. He was one of the early Sahaba to embrace Islam and joined the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in this journey to Islam in the difficult times of Mecca. And we all know Abdullah bin Umm Maktoum, a whole surah was revealed for him in the Quran about him. عبس وتولى أن جاءه الأعمى وما يدريك لعله يزكى أو يذكر فتنفعه الذكرى. When the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, remember to say صلى الله عليه وسلم, he was giving da'wah to the Qurayshis, to the chieftains of Quraysh, to the VIPs in the Meccan community. Where Abdullah shows up and he's a Muslim. يا محمد علمني مما علمك الله. يا رسول الله علمني مما علمك الله. And Abdullah was deaf. Was blind, so he cannot see. And because he is blind, he tries to make himself heard, so he is raising his voice and his love, and he cannot understand the situation, so he's insisting and insisting and insisting. And the Prophet ﷺ, Rahma lil alameen, mercy to the mankind. The Prophet ﷺ didn't even give him any objection. He only frowned. He frowned in the face of a blind man. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed the surah that many of our kids memorize. وَمَا يُدْرِيكَ, he's kind of rebuking the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Why do you turn your face to those chieftains? To those celebrities? Why are you giving them attention? أَمَّا مَنْ جَاءَكَ يَسْعَى وَهُوَ يَخْشَى فَأَنْتَ عَنْهُ تَاهَى. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was not wasting time giving da'wah to those important personnel in Quraysh. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was telling the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and telling us, every single member of this community matters. Everyone should be listened to. Everyone should be given their attention and everyone should be given their responsibilities. Abdullah bin Umm Maktoum migrates from Mecca to Medina. And in Medina, the masjid is built and now it's time to call for prayer. And between the different options, the option of al-adhan was suggested. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam likes this and he wants two people to give the adhan. And the two people who were selected were among the category that we can call now, right now, as minorities. One of them, an ex-slave, someone who was sold and tortured, Bilal bin Rabah al-Abd al-Habashi, who was an ex-slave, but he was freed. He was chosen for this great mission. And the second person was Abdullah bin Umm Maktoum. If you are lost, if you don't have one talent, guess what? Allah has given you a lot more. And you have to utilize it, and the community has to utilize it for you. Abdullah bin Maktoum comes to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with an appeal for an excuse. Ya Rasulullah, I cannot come to the salat, to the congregation prayer. I come and people help me and all those roads of Medina. Give me an excuse, give me an exception to pray at home. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked him, هل تسمع النداء? Do you hear the adhan? Are you in the vicinity of the masjid? And he said, yes. He said, إذن فلبي. Answer the call of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You live close to the masjid, you have no excuse not to pray with the congregation. So again, raising the bar on Abdullah ibn Maktoum, and we can say that he was always included in the politics and in the community life of the Medina. Whenever the Prophet ﷺ would travel outside of Medina for battlefield, he would want someone to be in check, to be appointed to, you know, to lead the Medina. And he chose none but Abdullah ibn Maktoum. 14 times he was appointed a Dawani, as the Khalifa, when the Prophet ﷺ is in the battlefield. And there's a lot of people who are left in the Medina, like the women and the children and the elderly and the disabled. But then Abdullah ibn Maktoum, he was the one, he was the go-to person when the Prophet ﷺ is not around. Again, they are not people with special needs. They are people with special talents, and we have to use them and we have to utilize them. Towards the end of his life, Abdullah ibn Maktoum, his iman is growing bigger and bigger. And his involvement with the community is going bigger and bigger. Because you are what you leave behind. What matters is what you give to others. Abdullah, the Muslim army, was traveling to Al-Qadisiyah to fight with the Persians. And he said, I want to go with you to the battlefield. I am not less than joining the battlefield with the Muslims. And he goes to the battle. And he cannot carry any weapon. He cannot, you know, fight physically. But he's like, you know what? The most important part of the Muslim army is the carrier of the flag. Hamil al-Raya. The one who carries the flag of the Muslims. Because he's the center point. Back in the days, they didn't have GPS. So how can all the other, you know, Muslim soldiers know that, know where the direction and the center point and everything? So he's like, I'm going to carry the flag of Islam. I will never let go the flag of Islam until I die. And if we are losing and the Muslim army is running away, guess what? I'm blind, I cannot see. I'm not running away. I will keep on carrying the flag of Islam until I die. And he was martyred. He died in the battlefield carrying the flag of Islam, the blind man, Abdullah ibn Maktoum. Again, there are people who are disabled truly because of emotional disability. Because they cannot get beyond their sin or their laziness or their negativity. But Abdullah ibn Maktoum is not someone with special needs, but with special talents. We have a lot of other examples in our Muslim history. I will share only one more, which is Mu'adh bin Jabal, radiallahu anhu wa arda. He used to walk with a limp. وَكَانَ أَعْرَجًا. So if he were to be picked for a marathon runner, or to be picked, you know, for a very important part in the Muslim army, he wouldn't take that place. You know, subhanAllah, one of the scholars, he was asked, that تزوجت امرأة وإذا بها عرجاء. That like I proposed to a woman, she's good and everything, but she walks with a limp. So should I divorce her or whatever? So the scholar told him, إذا كنت تزوجت بها لتسابق بها فردها. That if you married her only to, you know, to go and, you know, have her in a race and bid on her, then no, just divorce her. So sometimes we focus on the problem and we forget that there's a lot of opportunities. You have a lot of talents, not that little thing that Allah has taken from you for a wisdom that He knows. So Mu'adh bin Jabal, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sends Mu'adh to the people of Jabal, to the people of Yemen. And subhanAllah, he would tell them, بَعَثْتُ عَلَيْكُمْ رَجُلًا مِنْ خِيَارِ أَهْلِي. One of the core Sahaba, he was sent to Al-Yaman. And subhanAllah, in our Muslim community in Detroit area, we have a lot, we have like thousands of Muslims from Yemen, and their hasanat, and their salat, and their Quran is bi mizan hasanat. Mu'adh bin Jabal, the guy who used to walk with a limb. Again, it's not people with disabilities, they are people with special talents. They were remembered for what they offered. They were remembered for what they have given to the Muslim community. But the truly disabled, those who truly need your attention, those who need your dua, those that you really have to sympathize for them and cry for them, are those who are forbidden from guidance. Allah said in the Quran, in Surah Al-Baqarah, صُمٌ بُكْمٌ عُمْيٌ فَهُمْ لَا يَرْجِعُونَ. They are deaf, they are blind, and they are mute, and they cannot come back to the truth. Allah is talking about the hypocrite in Surah Al-Baqarah, and He's giving an example of people who are living in the desert, and it's the middle of the night, and it is a pitch black, dark desert. Allah said in Surah Al-Baqarah, مَثَلُهُمْ كَمَثَلِ الَّذِي اسْتَوْقَدَ نَارًا فَلَمَّا أَضَاءَتْ مَا حَوْلَهُ ذَهَبَ اللَّهُ بِنُورِهِمْ. Their example is the example of someone who started a big fire. And the man who started this big fire, according to the scholars, is Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, who started this fire, and he's enlightening this light of darkness, of guidance, to remove the darkness and to show people the way to the straight path. فَرَجُلْ إِسْتَوْقَدَ نَارًا. And some other scholars say it is Musa alayhi salam. But then, now the light is there. Now nobody has an excuse not to be guided. Nobody has an excuse not to be shown the straight path. Brothers, can we come to the front a little bit? Jazakumullah khair. تَفَسَّحُوا فِي الْمَجَالِسِ تَفْسَحُوا يَفْسَحِ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ. To leave some room, inshallah, for other brothers. So this man starts the fire. And nobody has an excuse not to be guided. فَلَمَّا أَضَاءَتْ مَا حَوْلَهُ. Now everyone can see. ذَهَبَ اللَّهُ بِنُورِهِمْ. Allah has taken away their light, meaning their eyesight, because the eye and the eyesight is the tool that we can get the guidance for. So they became blinded. And those are the hypocrites. Those are people who were calling, who were begging for help, begging for guidance, begging and asking, where's the next messenger? فَلَمَّا أَضَاءَتْ مَا حَوْلَهُ ذَهَبَ اللَّهُ بِنُورِهِمْ وَتَرَكَهُمْ فِي ظُلُمَاتٍ لَا يُبْصِرُونَ. They are left in complete darkness. They cannot see. They have no access for this guidance. Then Allah continues and says, صُمٌ بُكْمٌ عُمْيٌ فَهُمْ لَا يَرْجِعُونَ. They are deaf. They are mute. They cannot talk. And they are blinded. Now someone might say, why the three in one person? By the way, it's not or, it's and. So the same characters are in the same human being. Why? If somebody is blind, but they can talk, at least they cannot see the fire, but maybe they can call for help. Hey, can someone guide me? So you can either talk, ask for help, and somebody will take your hand. Or you can hear somebody telling you that there's light, there's guidance, so come this way. But these people, subhanAllah, they have lost all of their access to guidance. صُمٌ بُكْمٌ عُمْيٌ فَهُمْ لَا يَرْجِعُونَ. They cannot get back. Get back to what? Get back to the road of guidance. They can get back to the safe path. This is the example of the hypocrites. This is the example of someone who's indulged in a sin, immersed in a sin, and sinning is not hypocrisy. Don't get me wrong. The problem is when someone does not want to be guided. Someone goes to the sheikh asking for a fatwa, and they already know the answer. They already think, they already made up their mind. So this is the problem. The problem with hypocrisy. The problem with someone who's not interested in getting guidance. Even if somebody invites them. Even if the Prophet ﷺ himself is the one giving the khutbah, not myself. They will not have this access to any of the guidance. Those are the truly disabled people. Those are the people that need your attention. You need to cry for. You need to pay. You need to really exert more effort towards, you know, towards them and give them more attention. But for our brothers with special talents, for brothers with special needs, I have few messages for them, and then messages for the Muslim community. The first one is, subhanAllah, an amazing word for Ibn al-Qayyim, where he says, مَا أَغْلَقَ اللَّهُ عَلَىٰ عَبْدٍ بَابًا بِحِكْمَتِهِ إِلَّا وَفَتَحَ لَهُ بَابَيْنِ بِرَحْمَتِهِ. That never does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala close a door on a slave, on a person, on a human being, out of his own hikmah, out of his own wisdom, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah, when he does that, he will open two doors for him out of his rahmah, out of his mercy. So Allah might close one door for you, might take away one thing from you. Allah has given you much more. Abdullah ibn Maktoum, he had this beautiful voice and loud voice. So this was, it was utilized to the good use. And he was inviting the Sahaba for prayer. And everyone among us here in this room, even if we think that we are deprived from Allah, although we have, alhamdulillah, we are living better than many people on this world, Allah has might have taken one thing from you, but Allah has given you a lot. So you have to look at what Allah has given you. And you have to realize that this life is a test. This life is not meant to be the ultimate pleasure and the ultimate happiness. A woman came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. قالت يا رسول الله إني أصرع. I get seizure. And when I get seizure, I don't have control over myself. وإني أتكشف. And I just, my body is vibrating, so my body gets exposed. فادعوا الله لي. So make dua for me. Make dua so that Allah stops this, you know, difficulty. It's too much. So Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam tells her, And she to doubt you. If you want, I will make dua for you. And it will go in a second. That's the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam making dua for you. وَإِنْ شِئْتِ صَبَرْتِ وَلَكِ الْجَنَّةِ If you want, you can be patient. Just be silent about it and struggle against it. And you will have paradise guaranteed for you. Allah says, إِنَّمَا يُوَفَّ الصَّابِرُونَ أَجْرَهُمْ بِغَيْرِ حِسَابٍ The patient people will get their payback, they will get their recompense with no account, with no limit. بِغَيْرِ حِسَابٍ She said, okay, I will be patient. I want paradise. I don't want this dunya. I have one more request. Please make dua for Allah to protect me from exposing my body. That was her number one concern. It's okay, I can be patient on that moment. I can be patient on the disease, but I don't want my body to be exposed. She was caring about her modesty. A message to the brothers before the sisters. Modesty. That was the number one thing that she didn't want to lose, even if she had to struggle and, you know, and be patient on her difficulty, on her disease. The last point should, okay, if that's the case, then does Islam preaches and teaches that we should accept this, we should like, you know, being sick and being poor and what have you. Al-Husayn ibn Ali, radiallahu anhu, he was brought with a statement by Abu Dharr al-Ghifari. قيل للحسين إن أبا ذر يقول إن الفقر أحب إلي من الغنى وإن السقم أحب إلي من العافية. So he was told, Abu Dharr says, that poverty, being poor, is more beloved to me than being rich. And to be sick is more beloved to me than to be healthy. So what do you think about it? So he said, رحم الله أبا ذر. I disagree with Abu Dharr, but may Allah mercy Abu Dharr. You know, adab al-ikhtilaf. You know, it's not, he didn't bash him. I have a slight disagreement with Abu Dharr. أما أنا فأقول من اتكل على حسن اختيار الله له لم يتمنى غير ما اختاره الله. Whoever trusts Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in everything that Allah chooses for you, you would never wish anything different than what Allah has chosen for you. So don't say, yeah, I want this hardship to come and I will be patient. No. Allah knows your ability. Allah knows your strength. Allah knows your weakness. So just wish that whatever Allah has written for you is the best and thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and be patient about it. Allah might test us with good or with bad, with poverty or with richness. وَنَبْلُوكُمْ بِالشَّرِّ وَالْخَيْرِ فِتْنَةً Allah might test us with evil, with difficulties and calamities, and Allah might test us with goodness, with khayr. And the test of khayr comes with a fitna, because it's more tribulation. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to allow us to serve our Muslim community. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to guide us and guide people through us and make us reasons for those to be guided. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله العظيم لي ولكم فاستغفروه فيا فوز المستغفرين. الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. Dear respected brothers and sisters, I tried to share some thoughts, some reflections on a deaf Muslim class that we are giving and I'm attending myself, and actually I am getting from it more than I'm putting into it. We talked about that those are people with special talents, not special needs. We shared some examples of great Sahaba, of great companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and how they left a great legacy despite the weakness or the difficulties that they were tested in their life. So one of the take-home messages that I would like to share, the first one is a fundraising dinner that will take place in this community, in Tawheed Center, in April 19, Sunday, April 19, and it will be for the same organization, for Global Deaf Muslims, and this is basically will be to raise funds to translate the Quran to ASL, American Sign Language. You cannot imagine the happiness on their face when they watch Surah Al-Fatiha, not through me and a translator, but directly on YouTube for American Sign Language translation of Surah Al-Fatiha. So they are putting this effort, Global Deaf Muslims, to translate this to others. So please, there are flyers outside if you want to take some of the flyers. So that's the first take-home message. Second take-home message, as I said, there are people around us who physically might be fine, but they have emotional disabilities, who may need to be included, who may need your care, your attention, who are stuck in their loop of laziness or pessimism or negativity, and they need your help. They need your attention. One of the beauty of this class that when we give information, we wait for feedback and we ask for feedback. So I can say that maybe I'm teaching in 1 hour Surah Al-Ikhlas or Surah Al-Falaq. But I am guaranteed 100% that the information is reaching them because you need always continuous feedback. We need this even with those who are apparently the five senses are working. So that's number two. And the number three, volunteer for the community. This class is based on volunteers. People who have nothing to do with the masjid, they came. And we have someone driving all or taking the bus from a distant place only to come to us and improve his American sign language skills so he can give to the others. The community has a lot of resources, has a lot of needs, and please try to volunteer. Try to start your own class. Try to include many members of this community with your dua, with your attention, with your activity, your local masjid, whether this masjid or other masajid. There's a lot of events. And maybe you might not, you know, understand the need of those events, but wallahi, there are people out there who will need to be included, who will need to feel that they are part of a single, of a Muslim family. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us inshallah from those who call to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and who work for the sake of Islam. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us inshallah remembered in this world and in the afterlife after we leave this world. Allahumma ighfir lana dhunubana wa israfana fi amrina wa thabbit aqdamana wa ansurna ala alqawm alkafirin. Rahmanaka rahmat bi'ibadika almustad'afin fi al-Yaman wa fi Syria wa fi al-Iraq wa fi فلسطين وفي مصر وفي ليبيا وفي كل أرض وتحت كل سماء. اللهم كن مع إخواننا المستضعفين في كل مكان. اللهم كن معهم ولا تكن عليهم, وانصرنا وانصرهم ولا تنصر عليهم, واجعل لنا في نصرتهم أوفر الحظ والنصيب. اللهم اهدنا واهد بنا واجعلنا سببا لمن اهتدى, واهد الناس على أيدينا. اللهم اجعلنا هداة مهديين غير ضالين ولا مضلين, سلما لأوليائك حربا على أدائك يا رب العالمين. ربنا اغفر لنا ولإخواننا الذين سبقونا بالإيمان, ولا تجعل في قلوبنا غلا للذين آمنوا, ربنا إنك رؤوف رحيم. وصل اللهم وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم, والحمد لله رب العالمين. وأقم الصلاة إن الصلاة تنهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر.
الله أكبر. الله